going on, brothers, my sisters? Hope all is well. Shalom, shalom. Another day, another dollar to get for the Lord. I just got out not too long ago. Just refreshed myself. You know one thing that I don't see a lot of people doing in churches? Like all of the years that I have grown up and I've been in and out of church, I never seen people really use oil in the churches that I went to. They never use oil to, you know, like to bless people and things like that. And now that I'm really like seeking God's face, and now that I, you know, I'm discovering the virtues of Jesus Christ and his power through the Holy Spirit, and how he can really do wonders with oil and of course water. And I can just go on YouTube and see how people really use the things that he created for us to use as a point of contact, as a healing, and to heal people from sicknesses and, you know, bondage and things like that. And I just don't think the churches today are really promoting that enough. It's as if they don't believe in the power of anointing oil and blessed water. So as time goes on and you guys really get into you know, abiding in God and letting him abide in you, you guys should really study or, you know, look it up on how powerful oil is and water is when you're blessing, when you're anointing, when you speak over it. Because, you know, everything you say is a spirit. You know, the words are powerful. You can even speak life and death. You get, as he said, it's power and life and death in the tongue. So, same thing when you bless oil and water. You can use it for anything. You can use it as a point of contact, anoint your home, or even yourself. So, it's funny how I met all this on my own. God showed me plenty of things, and it's a blessing that he allowed me to gain confidence. And, you know, you gotta have faith, and because everything that Jesus did, you and me can do as well. So just like if you have a sick or you have a flu, you can bless the oil and anointing oil to get delivered from whatever flu you have. If you have what's it called, bronchitis. Use oil, and as well as prayer and use oil. If you use both of those, that would be a wonderful, wonderful, powerful thing. And I think we just need to put that at the forefront. I don't know why churches don't speak on this as much as the people preach and sing on TV with these big churches. They don't talk about the healing as much. You know, it's like they really stripped the authentic power of the Holy Spirit. You know, you don't see no supernatural healing in the churches like that. So, So, I'm in the book of Jeremiah, of course, today. Yesterday, I was in Isaiah, and then briefly, I was in Hosea. Today, we're switching it up, Jeremiah. And this is about the thoughts of peace. You know, this is about God allowing his children to go into captivity. As I go back to the page that it was on, it says the thoughts of peace, but before it says the yokes of iron. So yokes of iron, so that's like captivity as well. It says right here, for verse 4, verse 14, chapter 20, it says, "For thus said the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, I have put a yoke of iron upon the neck of all these nations, that they may serve and recognize the king of the Lord, and they shall serve him. And now I have given him the peace of the field also." So, a yoke. That's a type of bondage. You can have some type of yoke. You can have yokes of lust, yoke of affliction, yoke of addiction, yoke of repetitive sickness. You know, there's many irons, there's many yokes. So God has gave you and me the ability to break these yokes. And it's through the Spirit of the living God. It's not by our power, it's not by our might, but it's through the Spirit that allows us to destroy these yokes. And they don't talk about this as much, so it don't matter what color you are, no matter where you're from, we're all able to do this. You know, and God, he's more than you. He's delighted for you to become his child. And, you know, as long as you are rejecting Jesus Christ, you know, he can't claim him as his child. You know, it's like, yeah, he's for forced to cheat, he's forced to spit you out. So of course when you die, you know, when you leave this earth, you won't be a respecter of him, so he'll cast you straight to hell. That's why it's sad for atheists, for people who strictly, or it's sad for atheists and people who don't really believe in Jesus. They have doubts. And that's the whole plan of the wicked one, put doubt. And yeah, doubt. They're like, is God really here? No. Of course, when a person goes through so much in life, they start to really doubt that it's a real living God. But when you think about it, how would you only be here at the end of the day? If it wasn't a God, of course. I mean, it's just like a movie, you know? The good movies, some sci-fi movies, it's always a bad guy versus a good guy. It's always an evil God or a good God. So, you know, same thing. God is the Superman of his world, but powerful. It's 100 times, a million times stronger than the Superman as a portrayed in the movies. He is a creator. He's everywhere at once. There's nothing that God can do. You know, there's nothing that's outside his reach. He's omnipresent, omnipotent. He can see all things, and he's everywhere at once. So it's nothing that he can't do. At the end of the day, he got his angels all over the place. Just like his wicked spirits all over the place, his angels all over the place. But it's more of them than them. So it's more of angels than it is of evil humans. So, with that being said, I'm going to continue with the reading. Alright. I guess we can start. We can start with 13 because I need this to hit your soul. And this isn't to make you feel good at the end of the day. Even though once you read certain scriptures about God's promises, of course, that's to give you peace. But as far as other people who don't live a life of, you know, fruitfulness, people who don't live a life pleasant to God, this will wake you up, you know, because his word, everything in his Bible is promises. Everything that's written in his book, it will come to pass. Like I said, like people always been saying throughout like history repeats itself in his Bible is history. So, let's go. It says, I'm going to start from chapter 27. It says, verse 13, it says, why will ye die, they on thy people, by the sword, by the famine, and by the pestilence, as the Lord has spoken against the nation that will not serve the kingdom? So, Nebuchadnezzar was a king. He put this guy, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, over the nation. So, he did this because of, you know, of the disobedience. So, he'll even use, you know, people who aren't good, and put them in position to rule over people. Same thing. So it says, why will you die? And thou people by the sword, by the famine, by the pestilence. So famine, of course, is like a lack of spiritual satisfaction. So people are highly stressed, highly distressed, going through suicidal things, thoughts, going through affliction of the mind and the body, you know, and it's all due to because of disobedience and rebellion against God. Of course, people choose to serve other gods and not serve Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And they want to worship money, they want to worship, you know, technology. And of course, people are worshipers of themselves, so God is going to humble people. You know, he's going to put a yoke of iron on these people. And it's to wake you up and to get you to come to him and surrender to God, not to surrender and to conform to this world. This world doesn't wake you up. This world doesn't give you peace. This world doesn't give you satisfaction. Only God's spirit and God alone gives you satisfaction. So the Lord has spoken against the nation that will not serve the king of Babylon. Therefore hearken not unto the words of the prophet that speak unto you, saying, ye shall not serve the king of Babylon. For they prophesy a lie unto you. For I have not sent them, said the Lord, yet they prophesy a lie in my name, that I might drive you out, that ye might perish, ye and the prophets that prophesy unto you. So, of course, he's talking about these false prophets. These false prophets that are saying, God told me this, and God said, he told me that you're going to be a business owner. He said, God told me that you're going to be a millionaire. Things like that. And this one is saying Hananiah's false prophecy. Yeah, false prophecy. And so we can continue. It says, also I speak to the priests and to all these people, saying, thus said the Lord, hearken not to the words of your prophecy unto you, saying, behold, the vessels of the Lord's house shall now shortly be brought again from Babylon. So brought again from Babylon, brought from captivity, and spiritual slavery and bondage. It says, for they prophesy a lie unto you. Hearken not unto them, serve the king of Babylon, and live. Wherefore should this city be laid waste? So, of course, let me take that back. I apologize. Nebuchadnezzar was a servant of God. So he put Nebuchadnezzar, he made him rule over the nation. So anyone who didn't, you know, honor Nebuchadnezzar, you know, they either be put to death or go through high amounts of pain and suffering. Because life is suffering in itself. And so it says, verse 17, hearken not unto them, serve the king of Babylon, and live. Wherefore should this city be laid waste? Question mark. But if they be prophets, and if the word of the Lord be with them, let them now make intercession of the Lord's host, that the vessels which are left in the house of the Lord and in the house of the king of Judah and at Jerusalem go not to Babylon. So at this point, Babylon can either be a physical place and a spiritual place. And God is not a respecter of any person who is not of God and that's not led by the Holy Spirit. It's talking about, I prophesy this, I prophesy that. And that's demonic when you think about it. It's your mind, people. And it's not, it's something else giving you those visions, those false visions. So it says, Hananiah is false prophecy. So God is going to bring destruction against people who, you know, give you false visions. So if you listen to that's people like your tarot cards, anybody, if you're dealing with anybody who's dealing with anything else outside of being a Christian, I believe in Jesus Christ, prophesying. I see you doing this, or if you're looking in the future, that's an abomination. And God is going to destroy those type of people. And I can keep going. So, but go not to Babylon. Verse 19. For thus said the Lord of hosts, concerning the pillars and concerning the sea and concerning the bases and concerning the rest of the vessels that remain in the city. So he's talking about the remaining people in the city. It said residue. Residue is like leftover dust. When you think about it. So it says pillars. And of course, God, he can come through as a pillar of fire and a cloud. So for thus said the Lord of hosts, concerning the pillars and concerning the sea and concerning the bases and concerning the residue, otherwise they remain in the city, which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, took not. When he carried away the captive Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from Jerusalem to Babylon, and all the nobles of Judah and Jerusalem. So the nobles, of course, there's people of power in the world. He'll even bring these people into captivity until they surrender to God. One more verse, and it says, verse 21, yeah, thus said the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, concerning the vessels that remain in the house of the Lord, and in the house of the king of Judah and of Jerusalem. They shall be carried to Babylon, and there shall they be until the day that I visit them, said the Lord. Then will I bring them up and restore them to this place. So people are going to be, you know, wandering in Babylon until the day that the Lord Almighty comes back the second time. And of course, first you have the second coming of God, then you have, you know, like the end of the world. So we're not even in that prophecy yet. This is going to be the second coming. So God is, he's just judging people. He's either going to get rid of people, he's coming to get rid of people, and he's coming to, of course, judge people. You know, they'll have to, you know, go through everything. They're going to have to go through suffering because of, you know, the action they did, you know, worshiping false gods, you know, living a sinful life. You know, that's why you should repent right now and accept God as your Lord and Savior now. You know, you're going to go through everything that we do. Nothing goes unpunished. So just because you're going through turmoil, high levels of pain, affliction, that doesn't mean God spits you out. He hates you. He needs to do this, you know, for us to learn our lesson. You know, disobedience, you gotta get corrected. So, yeah, I'm not separate from that as well. You know, I've been through many battles because of the decisions I made. God just wanted me to, you know, he wanted me to repent and not to go back to those things. And he wants us to be delivered from certain behaviors that defile the spirit of God. Of course, we're supposed to be filled with joy, peace, happiness, forgiveness, meekness. doesn't want us to walk around with unforgiving, hateful, walking around with strife, bitterness, resentment towards people. Just because they heard our feelings, God wants us to walk in His spirit. You know, imagine Jesus Christ was spit on, ridiculed, reviled, persecuted, and He didn't do anything. You know, He was here for the betterment of people. So we got to be a representation, just like Yahweh. You know, we got to be. Got to advance His kingdom. We got to be vessels and instruments. You know, it'll take a sacrifice. You'll lose family and friends and people you thought that was really close to you. You're going to think you really know people until you step with God. When you step with God on that journey, you know, you're going to find out that closest friend don't like you no more because the enemy could be influencing them because they're not of the same spirit. Just like the same spirit that you carry inside of you, they don't have it. They don't respect what God is about. They don't even think twice. They might get up every day, smoke, drink, sell drugs, you know, and anyone can change, but you have to want to. And people are put in a way, and it's like a stumbling block. God wants to separate you and me from people that are human blockades and hindrances to our growth and to our godly ordained destiny. So, yeah. That's all I got for you guys today, and I'll do some more. I might do another video tonight. So just know, even though you might be going through high levels of pain, don't give up. You know, pray to God, ask Him to give you peace of mind in the midst of a storm, and pray to God to give you insight on what to do and how to go about your life. To be able to endure. Because God is a savior. He saves everyone who endures the end, who faint not. Anyone who is tempted, going through temptation, and endures the end, He will reward, He will save you. So that's what it's about. You endure the end. God bless you guys. I'm going to finish this with a prayer. Lord God, thank you, Lord Jesus, for your grace and mercy. Thank you, Lord God, for waiting up each and every day. Thank you, Father God, for the little thing. I pray for each and every person that may watch this, Father God. I pray that you give them a spirit to hear, a spirit to understand, eyes to see, and ears to hear. And I pray that you deliver them from any type of spirit that may be hindrance and maybe keep them in bondage mentally and spiritually. Lord, take every yoke off their mind, their body, their spirit, and soul. In Jesus' mighty name, cause your face to shine upon them and deliver them from anything, a behavior, or the impulse that is of the flesh. That might keep them in going through spiritual attack. Father God, for we know through sin, if we keep sinning, we open doors and we allow, you know, the devil to afflict us, to hurt us, and things like that. So give us insight, understanding. You know, pray that you touch your children. You know, that was a walk, a straight and narrow, for it leads to eternal life instead of wide. Which leads to destruction. So, have you your way. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And we clean and clear that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. God will bless you.